Calorama, a recorded books hybrid imprint, presents The Point of No Return, American Democracy at the Crossroads, by Thomas Byrne Edsall, read by Mike Chamberlain. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. The years following the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965 saw the abandonment of the Democratic Party by the white American South. That partisan realignment led slowly but directly to the arrival of Donald Trump, a supremely dangerous man, an enemy of racial justice, at the pinnacle of American power, where despite his narrow loss in 2020, he still lodges. Many of the conflicts dividing Americans today have their roots in the civil rights movement and broader rights revolutions of the 1960s and 1970s, and in the reactionary response to those revolutions. Progressive insurgencies granted full citizenship to African Americans, empowered previously marginalized populations, and diversified the Democratic Party. They also mandated legal and constitutional protections for women, ethnic and racial minorities, criminal defendants, the poor, homosexuals, the handicapped, and the mentally ill. The strategy that Trump, ever the opportunist, adopted when he launched his bid for the presidency was the white supremacist position that had been unambiguously articulated nearly six decades earlier by arch-conservative National Review editor William F. Buckley in his August 1957 essay, Why the South Must Prevail. The issue is whether the white community in the South is entitled to take such measures as are necessary to prevail, politically and culturally, in the areas in which it does not predominate numerically. The sobering answer is yes. Buckley argued that this is because, for the time being, it is the advanced race. The question, then, as far as the white community is concerned, is whether the claims of civilization supersede those of universal suffrage. Buckley's answer: the National Review believes that the South's premises are correct. If the majority wills what is socially atavistic, then to thwart the majority may be, though undemocratic, enlightened. By the late 1960s, it had become uncommon for people to explicitly express racially insensitive views. Buckley soon renounced his own editorial, and Republicans in general swiftly shifted to code words and phrases, such as law and order, the silent majority, and welfare queens. Still, the rights revolutions had given political conservatives a powerful tool to mobilize voters, especially lower and middle-income non-college-educated whites who felt the Democratic Party had abandoned them. In 1964, many of these Southern voters supported Barry Goldwater, who carried Louisiana, Mississippi, Georgia, Alabama, and South Carolina. By January 1976, Ronald Reagan picked up the racist mantle and regaled his Asheville, North Carolina audience on the campaign trail with this oft-disputed anecdote. In Chicago, they found a woman who holds the record. She used 80 names, 30 addresses, 15 telephone numbers to collect food stamps, Social Security, veterans benefits for four non-existent deceased veteran husbands, as well as welfare. In fact, Reagan added, her tax-free cash income alone has been running at $150,000 a year. By the time of Reagan's 1980 victory, the Republican Party had become the home of racial reaction. Fueling the conservative response to the civil rights revolution of the mid-1960s was the onset of a surge in immigration to the United States following enactment of the Immigration and Nationality Act of 1965. According to the official House of Representatives' description of the law, Congress erected a legal framework that prioritized highly skilled immigrants and opened the door for people with family already living in the United States. The popular bill passed the House 318-95. The law capped the number of annual visas at 290,000, which included a restriction of 20,000 visas per country per year. But policymakers had vastly underestimated the number of immigrants who would take advantage of the Family Reunification Clause. In 1970, 4.7% of this country's population was foreign-born. By 2019, that had shot up to 13.7%. In actual numbers, there were 9.6 million immigrants in 1970. In 2019, there were 44.9 million, a 263% increase, with most of the new immigrants coming from Latin America, Asia, and Africa, rather than the countries of Northern, Western, Eastern, or Southern Europe. For Trump, it has been a simple matter to focus native discontent on the surge in foreign-born, low-wage workers competing for jobs and, in the view of his partisans, transforming American culture. He has demonized immigrants in countless ways, including by disparaging countries with majority black populations and supporting participants in the August 2017 Unite the Right rally in Charlottesville. Understanding the role of increasing racial and ethnic diversity in empowering the contemporary conservative movement is crucial to understanding contemporary American politics. But there is more to American politics than that. These developments are explored in my 1992 book, Chain Reaction: The Impact of Race, Rights, and Taxes on American Politics, and in my May 1991 Atlantic article, when the official subject is presidential politics, taxes, welfare, crime, rights, or values, the real subject is race. The post-1964 Democratic Party quickly became a biracial coalition, and more recently a multiracial, multi-ethnic coalition. An increasingly influential upscale wing has also emerged as growing numbers of white, college-educated voters abandoned the Republican Party and, supporting more liberal politics, became Democrats. The knowledge class in the post-World War II era has shaped and was shaped by the human rights, civil rights, anti-war, feminist, and gay rights movements, as well as by the broader sexual and information revolutions. Members of this class, academics, artists, editors, human relations managers, lawyers, librarians, architects, journalists, psychologists, social workers, teachers, and therapists, as well as those in engineering, the sciences, finance, and other technology-focused domains, have had their lives upended by the legalization of contraception and abortion, by no-fault divorce, feminism, new behavioral norms, the effective disappearance of censorship, and the abolition of mandatory military service. In the context of this ongoing state of flux, are concerns among the growing numbers of college-educated voters who are preoccupied with reproductive rights, the environment, self-actualization, nonviolence, aesthetic fulfillment, racial and gender equality, and the administration of justice. This upscale cohort within the Democratic coalition is intensely hostile to agendas of imposed moral orthodoxy, often to religious observance itself, and particularly to the agenda of the socially conservative right. The interests of these voters do not necessarily or reliably coincide with the priorities of the less privileged, and they often conflict with the values and religiosity of millions of middle and working class voters, many of them low wage with only high school educations, who often find themselves disempowered, annoyed by, and resentful of contemporary cultural trends. Across both parties, one's identity as a man or woman, as a heterosexual, homosexual, or transgender person, as white, black, or Hispanic, as a feminist, as a Southerner, as a Christian, as tolerant or a disciplinarian, as an individualist or collectivist, as a pacifist or militarist, as a cosmopolitan or provincial, as an egalitarian, these and more have become a part of one's being as a liberal or Democrat on one side, or as a conservative or Republican on the other. Contemporary partisan schisms are far deeper and more irresolvable than past conflicts that positioned economic liberals and the Democratic Party against free market advocates and the Republican Party. Particularistic identities across the spectrum have now become consistent and coherent, what political scientists call sorted, into two competing and increasingly hostile identities, progressive or conservative, Democrat or Republican. One's sense of self has become deeply entwined with one's partisan allegiance, escalating the stakes for both sides. The subordination of economic to cultural and racial issues as the prime factors in elections has imposed significant consequences on those least equipped to bear the costs. In effect, the internal realignment of the Democratic Party has left without effective representation the broad class interests of those in the bottom half of the income distribution, those millions of all races and ethnicities without college degrees and with household incomes in the 25th to 65th percentile, just when the need for a strong political voice has intensified, especially for those left behind by the exacerbation of global competition that began in the early 1970s. Over subsequent decades, American corporations have cut pay and benefits for many workers in order to compete with low-wage producers in foreign countries, abandoning the post-World War II concord between labor and management, and outsourcing production to factories abroad. While automation continues to transform the need for skills that used to be the province of human beings alone. Artificial intelligence, argued MIT economist Darren Acemoglu in a September 2021 essay, The Harms of AI, is being used and developed at the moment to empower corporations and governments against workers and citizens. If the deployment of artificial intelligence remains on this trajectory, in Acemoglu's view, it will likely produce various social, economic, and political harms. These include damaging competition, consumer privacy, and consumer choice, excessively automating work, fueling inequality, inefficiently pushing down wages, and failing to improve worker productivity, and damaging political discourse, democracy's most fundamental lifeblood. The fracturing of the left means there is no counterbalancing political force to reroute the thrust of AI more constructively. Beyond that, a weakened economic left gives the right what amounts to an open field to shape tax legislation, deregulation, and spending policies favoring the interests of those at the top. From roughly 1968 to the present, policymaking has been driven by the top quintile of the income distribution and by corporate America. Not only have economic conservatives benefited from a wounded adversary, but the most powerful economic forces, global competition, outsourcing, and accelerating digital revolution, the ability of corporations to move capital and operations across borders, have worked to their advantage and to the disadvantage of workers. Liberal theorists have repeatedly called for a wide range of structural reforms, some of which might have spread more evenly the costs and benefits of the ongoing post-industrial upheaval. These include a stronger safety net, a higher minimum wage, expanded health care, child care, and prescription drug coverage, more generous provision for the disabled and the aged, sharply increased spending on worker training, especially in community colleges, tax reform, trade policies with worker protections, and a complete revision of the National Labor Relations Act to account for globalization and robotization. No matter what their merits, these options have not had a chance, while the balance of economic power has been tilted so far to the right. The Labor Left Economic Policy Institute, in The State of Working America, correctly points to the growing tension between wages and productivity. A key feature of the labor market since 1973, one that was not present in prior decades, has been the stunning disconnect between the economy's potential for improved pay and the reality of stunted pay growth, especially since 2000. Productivity grew 80.4% between 1973 and 2011, when, as noted, median worker pay grew just 10.7%. Since 2000, productivity has grown 22.8%, but real compensation has stagnated across the board, creating the largest divergence between productivity and pay in the last four decades. Stagnant wage and benefit growth has not been due to poor overall economic performance, nor has it been inevitable. Rather, wage and benefit growth stagnated because the economy, as structured by the rules in place, no longer ensures that workers' pay rises in tandem with productivity. The question remains, why do the contemporary rules of the economy not ensure pay raises in proportion to improved productivity? There are global forces beyond national reach driving some of these trends, but insofar as the rules are set domestically, the issue is political power. And at the moment, those who would benefit from policies encouraging shared rewards from growing productivity are split between two political parties, unable to effectively promote their material interests. Evidence of the shift in emphasis from economic to cultural politics can be found in the contrast between voting in some of the nation's poorest white counties on the one hand, and voting in affluent suburbs on the other. Take 96.2% white McDowell County, West Virginia, where the median household income in 2020 was $25,997, compared with the national median of $67,340, and the poverty rate was 31.9%, compared with the national rate of 11.9%. In 1964, the county voted 83% to 17% for Lyndon Johnson over Barry Goldwater. In 2020, the county voted 78.9% to 20.4% for Trump over Joe Biden. Or take the entire state of West Virginia, which ranks 46th in median household income. In 1964, 51 of the state's 55 counties voted Democratic. In 2020 and 2016, all 55 of the state's counties cast majorities for Trump. In the 2020 election, 9 of the 10 counties in the United States with the highest median household income voted for Biden, including all of the top 5, Loudoun and Fairfax counties in Virginia, Santa Clara and San Mateo counties in California, and Los Alamos County in New Mexico. The Democratic Party, once the party of working men and women, is currently dominated by issues of race, gender, and sexuality. In recent elections, these issues have overridden economic divisions. State voting patterns are defined by the degree to which residents have entered into what has been called a second demographic transition, SDT. This transition, according to Ron J. Lestag of Vrije Universiteit of Brussels, has two components. The first principal component or factor describes typical SDT features such as the postponement of marriage, greater prevalence of cohabitation and same-sex households, postponement of parenthood, sub-replacement fertility, and a higher incidence of abortion. By contrast, the second principal component captures the family variables that generally lead to greater vulnerability of young women and children, such as teenage marriage and fertility, subsequent divorce, single-parent households, and children residing in the households of grandparents. Lestag elaborates further. The SDT starts in the 1960s with a series of multifaceted revolutions. First, there was the contraceptive revolution, with the introduction of hormonal contraception and far more efficient IUDs. Second, there was the sexual revolution, with declining ages at first sexual intercourse. And third, there was the gender revolution, questioning the sole breadwinner household model and the gendered division of labor that accompanied it. This demographic transition has transformed the Democratic Party, transferring agenda-setting power to the knowledge class. And this ascendant constituency is most concerned with protecting and advancing recently democratized rights, notably reproductive rights, the right to privacy, and women's rights, as well as a comprehensive commitment to cultural, ethnic, and racial diversity. These trends were apparent as early as the 1996 presidential campaign, when two of Bill Clinton's top advisors, Dick Morris and Mark Penn, reported that one of the most effective ways of predicting voter behavior was from answers to 5 questions. Do you believe homosexuality is morally wrong? Do you ever personally look at pornography? Would you look down on someone who had an affair while married? Do you believe sex before marriage is morally wrong? Is religion very important in your life? How did this come about? Figures 0.1 and 0.2, which can be found in the print and ebook versions of this book, compare the elections of 1976 between two centrist candidates, Jimmy Carter and Gerald Ford, and 2016, pitting Donald Trump against Hillary Clinton. The horizontal axis measures the percentage of each state's vote cast for the Republican candidates, including Evan McMullen in 2016, and the vertical axis measures the degree to which the population of a given state has entered the SDT. In this country, individual states have moved into the SDT at very different rates. Those rates have, in turn, become increasingly correlated with how each state votes in presidential elections. What Figure 0.1 shows is that as recently as 1976, the correlation between a state's ranking in the SDT and its partisanship in presidential elections was modest at best. States are scattered all over the plot. A host of states, from Massachusetts to Utah, are non-conforming outliers, placed far from the axis. Figure 0.2 shows how, in a matter of 40 years, the SDT becomes powerfully correlated with state voting. Instead of the scattergram seen in Figure 0.1, the states in 2016 form a neat line along the axis, with virtually no deviance from the overall pattern. In many respects, Lestag's SDT can be linked to the emergence of post-materialism and the value of self-expressive individualism, first described by the late Ronald Inglehart, a professor of political science at the University of Michigan, in his 1971 paper, The Silent Revolution in Europe, Intergenerational Change in Post-Industrial Societies. In three subsequent books, The Silent Revolution, 1977, Cultural Shift, 1989, and Cultural Evolution, 2018, Inglehart described the movement to post-materialism, which included the following: a shift in child-rearing values, from emphasis on hard work toward emphasis on imagination and tolerance as important values to teach a child; an environment of trust and tolerance, in which people place a relatively high value on individual freedom and have activist political orientations, attributes that, the political culture literature has long argued, are crucial to democracy; a shift away from deference to all forms of external authority. Submission to authority has high costs. The individual's personal goals must be subordinated to those of others. Tolerance of diversity and rising demands among citizens to have a say in what happens to them. The young are more tolerant of homosexuality than their elders, and they are more favorable to gender equality and more permissive in their attitudes toward abortion, divorce, extramarital affairs, and euthanasia. The feminization of society and declining willingness to fight for one's country. A systematic erosion of religious practices, values, and beliefs. When Lestag and Inglehart first explored the SDT and post-materialist values, an underlying assumption was that these were beneficent trends reflecting growing affluence, that as scarcity diminished, new generations would inevitably shift their focus from economic survival to matters of lifestyle, including the environment and the breakdown of racial and gender barriers. In the words of Inglehart and Pippa Norris, a professor at Harvard's Kennedy School, in their 2017 paper, Trump and the Populist Authoritarian Parties, The Silent Revolution in Reverse, during the post-war era, the people of developed countries experienced peace, unprecedented prosperity, and the emergence of advanced welfare states, making survival more secure than ever before. Post-war birth cohorts grew up taking survival for granted, bringing an intergenerational shift toward post-materialist values. In the mid-1970s, however, the post-war era of sustained, shared growth came to a halt, and the liberal order and the economic security that accompanied it began to fray. As foreign producers became competitive, globalization started to impose costs on American corporations and workers. Instead of shared prosperity, median salaries stagnated, while those at the top grew rapidly, driving new levels of inequality. A high school diploma lost its status as a sufficient credential for a middle-class job. Before long, big box stores, Walmart, Target, and Costco, and by the turn of the century, online commerce, Amazon, had begun to devastate small businesses and to decimate small towns. Faced with growing challenges at home and abroad, American corporations abandoned paternalistic employment policies that carried the implicit promise of employment for life. The corporate view of unions changed from ally to adversary, with worker demands seen as leading to dangerous increases in bottom-line costs. By the late 1970s, with the emergence of simultaneous inflation and stagnation, stagflation, and the threat to American industry from abroad, corporate America, joined by an ascendant conservative political movement, produced a powerful anti-tax, anti-regulatory movement. In order to regain strength in a globally competitive environment, business abandoned past obligations to workers, the state, and the community. Environmental and workplace safety rules, seniority protection, unions, pensions, health insurance, and loyalty to workers were abruptly viewed as unsustainable costs that allowed European and Asian companies to undercut domestic producers. These shifts in corporate employment policies coincided with a massive surge in immigration to the United States following the liberalizing policies of the Immigration and Nationality Act of 1965. For Trump, it was a simple matter to focus native discontent on the surge in foreign-born, low-wage workers competing for jobs and, in the view of his partisans, transforming American culture. The net effect of the two revolutions that have dominated American society for the past five decades, first, the social and cultural revolution, and second, the technological and economic revolution that transformed employment, corporate business models, and market expectations, imposed what was often viewed as a survival of the fittest ethos on the working and middle classes. Members of the upper middle class survived and often prospered under the new sink-or-swim regime, but the less well-off, especially those without college degrees, were ill-equipped to cope. It was at this stage that many liberals and the Democratic Party became preoccupied with the expanding cultural revolution, the plight of minorities, and various manifestations of identity politics, effectively forsaking the past commitment to class politics that had animated the left through the New Deal and Fair Deal eras. Emerging social-cultural movements, rooted in racial, sexual, religious, and gender, as opposed to class identities, produced a series of conservative and right-wing counter-cultural revolutions over the course of the next five decades. These included Nixon's silent majority, the Christian right, the Reagan Democrats, the angry white men, and the Tea Party, and culminated most recently in the Trump Revolution. Each development was opposed, in part or in whole, to a greater or lesser degree, to the temper of the SDT, the post-materialist values, to racial and ethnic diversity, to secularization, to reproductive rights, and to rapidly transforming gender roles. The Republican Party capitalized on the dislocation and conflict generated by rapid cultural modernization, exploiting wedge issues like abortion and gay marriage, which pushed voters' anger points and motivated turnout. In the conservative wave elections of 1980, 1994, 2010, and 2014, post-materialism, noted Engelhard and Norris, became its own gravedigger. As liberalism shifted from advocacy on behalf of the economic have-nots to an agenda of racial integration and personal fulfillment, policies of redistribution, legal protection of unions, and the defense of the material interests of the working class were subordinated. This, plus large immigration flows from low-income countries with different cultures and religions, stimulated a reaction in which much of the working class moved to the right in defense of traditional values, wrote Engelhard and Norris. The classic economic issues did not disappear, but their relative prominence declined to such an extent that non-economic issues became more prominent than economic ones in Western political parties' campaign platforms. For white working-class voters experiencing lost jobs, the hegemony of alien cultures, and the steady deterioration of their communities, the new value-laden, anti-materialist liberal agenda amounted to an insult. Ironically, these trends, which benefit Democrats, are arguably also fostering inequality. The late Princeton sociologist Sarah McClanahan, in Diverging Destinies, How Children Are Faring Under the Second Demographic Transition, wrote that while children born to the most educated women are gaining resources in terms of parents' time and money, those who were born to the least educated women are losing resources. The forces behind these changes include feminism, new birth control technologies, changes in labor market opportunities, and welfare state policies. I contend that Americans should be concerned about the growing disparity in parental resources, and that the government can do more to close the gap between rich and poor children. As sociocultural and identity issues displace an ideology based on economic class, not only do the incentives for liberalism and the Democratic Party to address class-based problems of mobility and inequality diminish, but the center-left becomes vulnerable to economic special interest pressures. Lobbies and trade associations, focused on the legislative process as a means to commercial goals, tax breaks, regulatory change, subsidies, and so forth, can more readily apply pressure through campaign contributions and grassroots mobilization to members of the House and Senate who lack a broad ideological commitment to those in the bottom three quintiles of the income distribution. In a parallel development, Democratic incumbents have become increasingly dependent on the votes of the affluent to win elections, making these politicians reluctant to threaten the interests of their upscale constituents. There are few better examples of Democratic susceptibility to special interest pressure than the continued preservation of the carried interest tax break through 4 years of Democratic control of Congress, from 2006 to 2010, and again after the 2020 election. The carried interest break provides an estimated $18 billion annually to wealthy hedge fund operators and beneficiaries of investment funds. For a Democrat seeking election, the easiest path to capitalize on Republican social and moral extremism had been to stress threats to reproductive rights, to the teaching of evolution, to gay marriage, and to the protection of transgender people. In many respects, this was, until recently, a successful strategy. In 7 of the last 8 presidential elections, the Democratic candidate has won the popular vote. As the January 2021 insurrection of the U.S. Capitol and the relentless, ongoing Republican efforts to have Trump illegitimately declared the winner of the 2020 election demonstrate, however, Democrats now face Republican adversaries who are determined not only to pare back the liberal state, but to sabotage democracy itself, to overturn the will of the voters, to overthrow majority control, and to attack the legitimacy of election outcomes, undermining the very essence of American democracy. At the same time, the Democratic Party's shift to post-materialist values has left millions of white working-class voters with no perceived choice except the Republican Party. For Republicans, the prospect of losing has become what political scientists describe as a normative threat, a danger to the moral order underpinning society. Many liberals and Democrats saw and see Trump and the Republican Party as a fully comparable existential threat. Victory for the opposition, in each case, raises the specter of moral collapse. There has been a precipitous and accelerating decline of the United States on measures of freedom and democracy. From 2010 to 2020, Freedom House, which ranks countries based on an analysis of the electoral process, political pluralism and participation, the functioning of the government, freedom of expression and of belief, associational and organizational rights, the rule of law, personal autonomy and individual rights, demoted the United States from 7th worldwide to 18th, just below Croatia, Argentina, and Romania. The erosion of U.S. democracy is remarkable, especially for a country that has long aspired to serve as a beacon of freedom for the world, the authors of the Freedom House study reported. The downward trend accelerated considerably over the last 4 years as the Trump administration trampled institutional and normative checks on its authority, cast aside safeguards against corruption, and imposed harsh and discriminatory policies governing immigration and asylum. In a ranking by The Economist magazine, the United States fell from 16th in 2006 to 26th in 2020 based on 5 categories: electoral process and pluralism, functioning of government, political participation, political culture, and civil liberties. The United States was described as a flawed democracy as opposed to a full democracy. 22 countries achieved full democracy status, led by Norway, New Zealand, and Finland. Among the 53 flawed democracies, the United States ranked just below France, Israel, Spain, and Chile, and just above Estonia and Portugal. These downward trends culminated in Trump's election in 2016, and, despite his defeat in 2020, in his continuing power over a majority of Republican voters. The collection that follows of New York Times opinion columns from 2015 onward provides a real-time account of how and why Trump managed to prevail, and an enlarged understanding of the forces that enabled his rise. The Trump era is not over yet. Forewarned is forearmed. 2015 to 2016. On June 16, 2015, when he announced his presidential bid, no one except perhaps Donald Trump himself anticipated not only that he would win the nomination and the presidency, but that he would lead a revolution within the Republican Party, crushing the dominant establishment wing while empowering the legions of white working-class voters whose ballots had produced victories but whose voices had remained peripheral. Single-handedly, Trump demonstrated the weakness of the network of donors, party officials, lobbyists, and politicians who, for decades, had picked the party's nominees. In one of the ironies of politics, Trump democratized the Republican Party, just as he turned it into an authoritarian institution. The columns that follow document the start of an abrupt and unexpected outcome in American politics, the emergence of an anti-democratic president who converted the Republican Party into a reflection of his own image. 1. The not-so-silent white majority. Between Richard Nixon's election by the silent majority in 1968 and Donald Trump's stunning victory in 2016, there have been 6 conservative waves that swept Republicans into office. Disaffected white voters without college degrees have been the driving force in all of them. This is surprising, not only because these voters were once the backbone of the Democratic coalition, but because they have steadily declined as a share of the electorate. The percentage of white voters without college degrees fell from 83% in 1960 to 36% in 2012. It was 34% this year. So why did they matter as much as they did in 2016? For one thing, Trump's 39-point lead among less well-educated whites surged past Mitt Romney's 25-point margin. This was enough to make up for the fact that Trump's margin of victory among whites with college degrees at 4 points, 49% to 45%, was well behind Romney's. Romney carried college-educated whites by 14 points, 56% to 42%. Despite their declining share of the electorate, non-college-educated white voters continued to exercise an outsized influence, as the silent majority of 1968 and 1972, the Reagan Democrats of 1980, the angry white men of 1994, the Tea Party insurgents of 2010, and now the triumphant Trump Republicans of 2016. Let's examine the history of this trend. In 1968, these white voters, often low or moderate income, disproportionately male, and clustered in exurban and rural areas, then as now, were crucial to the birth of the modern conservative coalition. That year, famously, Southern whites, angered by enactment of the 1964 Civil Rights Act and the 1965 Voting Rights Act, abandoned the Democratic Party in droves, and they were soon joined by many Northern whites opposed to court-ordered busing. The Democratic Party's commitment to civil rights prompted millions of white voters to cast ballots either for Richard Nixon, running as the Republican nominee, or for George Wallace, the segregationist Dixiecrat and former governor of Alabama, running as the nominee of the American Independent Party. Together, Nixon and Wallace won 56.9% of all votes in 1968, and more than 6 out of every 10 white votes, laying the groundwork for the conversion of the segregationist wing of the Democratic Party into a key component of the modern Republican Party. Democrats have made inroads into this coalition a few times, either by running more centrist Southerners like Jimmy Carter or Bill Clinton, or through the campaign magic of Barack Obama, who promised to transcend the red-blue divide. But this white Republican coalition has proved remarkably enduring. In the two elections before 1968, John F. Kennedy and Lyndon B. Johnson, both Democrats, averaged 55% of the white working-class vote. According to Rui Teixeira, then a senior fellow at the pro-democratic Center for American Progress, Hubert Humphrey and George McGovern, both Democrats, averaged 35% of that vote in 1968 and 1972. Since that time, many Republican candidates have tapped into anti-black bias without running as overt segregationists. The Republicans suddenly became the party of the white working class, Teixeira wrote on his blog. The election of Ronald Reagan in 1980 further strengthened the commitment of the white working class to Republican presidential candidates, especially in the North. It was not, however, until 1994, with the so-called Gingrich Revolution, that the Republican Party was able to finally rupture the continuing commitment of lower and moderate income whites to Democratic congressional candidates. Figures 1.1 and 1.2, derived from the 2000 book America's Forgotten Majority by Teixeira and Joel Rogers, show how the bottom fell out in 1994 for white working-class Democratic congressional support. Gingrich claimed responsibility for his party's 1994 victories. Bill Clinton's initial abandonment of the themes that he campaigned on in 1992 was, in fact, more important. In his first presidential run, Clinton promised welfare reform, a middle-class tax cut, and the commitment of his presidency to the ideal that if you work hard and play by the rules, you'll be rewarded. Clinton's first 2 years in office, however, were dominated by the issues of gays in the military, health care reform, and his attempt to make good on his vow to pick a cabinet that looks like America. The changed agenda proved disastrous for Democratic members of the House and Senate. Stanley Greenberg, Clinton's 1992 campaign pollster, wrote in the 1999 book The New Majority, Toward a Popular Progressive Politics, that the 1994 congressional debacle should be a reminder of what happens when Democrats lose touch with the lives of working people. Bill Clinton's election was accompanied by great hopes in the country, but over the next 2 years, those hopes turned to disappointment. On the eve of the off-year elections, Clinton seemed like a culturally liberal president who could not deliver. Greenberg continued, "The 1994 election was a disaster produced by a downscale working-class revolt against the Democrats. Support for congressional Democrats among high school graduates dropped 12 points to only 46%. Among white male high school graduates, support for the Democrats fell off a cliff, careening 20 points downward from 57% to 37%. The march of working and middle-class whites toward the Republican Party took another giant step forward in the Tea Party election of 2010, when they voted against Democratic congressional candidates by 30 points, 65% to 35%, providing crucial ballast for the Republicans as they gained 63 seats in the House. For many analysts and Democratic operatives, Obama's two victories in 2008 and 2012 marked the final collapse of the conservative coalition. Even the Republican Party, notably in the so-called autopsy report produced in 2013 by Reince Priebus, soon to be Trump's chief of staff, acknowledged that a white-dominated conservative alliance was doomed to defeat unless the party opened its doors in general and to Hispanics in particular. Which brings us to 2016. On one level, demographic change was moving in Hillary Clinton's direction. The overall white share of the electorate, which was 91% in 1960, continued to decline, falling to 72% in 2012 and 70% in 2016. How, then, is it possible that this supposedly fading constituency played such a decisive role in 2016? Two reasons. First, while Trump barely improved on Romney's margin among whites generally, the whites who did vote for Trump were significantly different from those who voted for Romney. Trump won non-college-educated whites by 14 points more than Romney, a modern-day record. Just as important, the working-class voters Trump carried by such huge margins were heavily concentrated in the Rust Belt states of Wisconsin, Ohio, Michigan, Iowa, and Pennsylvania, all states carried by Obama in 2012 and lost by Clinton in 2016. Together, these states cast 70 electoral college votes. Trump's voters were situated in a way that allowed them to exercise far more influence on the outcome in the electoral college than their overall numbers would suggest, enabling Trump to sweep across the Rust Belt to victory. This apostasy among white voters has certainly not gone unnoticed, and party strategists have long debated what, if anything, could be done to bring these voters back into the Democratic fold, particularly since the landslide defeat of 1984. In 1985, Democrats conducted two major studies of white working-class discontent, one by Greenberg, which looked at white workers and retirees who were members of the United Automobile Workers in Macomb County, Michigan, the other of 33 focus groups nationwide conducted by CRG, a marketing and polling firm. Greenberg found that for these voters, blacks constitute the explanation of their vulnerability and for almost everything that has gone wrong in their lives. This special status of blacks is perceived by almost all of these individuals as a serious obstacle to their personal advancement. Indeed, discrimination against whites has become a well-assimilated and ready explanation for their status, vulnerability, and failures. The CRG study was equally brutal. These voters have a whole set of middle-class economic problems today, and their party is not helping them. Instead, it is helping blacks, Hispanics, and the poor. They feel betrayed. CRG found that in the view of the white working class, the Democrats are the giveaway party, and giveaway means too much middle-class money going to blacks and the poor. The struggle to revive Democratic support among low- and moderate-income white voters has more recently become a regular subject on the Democratic Strategist, a website run by the Democratic activist Ed Kilgore, who was once the vice president for policy at the Democratic Leadership Council. Kilgore also publishes a newsletter, the White Working Class Roundtable. In the first issue of the newsletter, Kilgore wrote, "It has become increasingly clear that progressives and Democrats have no alternative except to challenge the hold that conservatives in the GOP have established over white working Americans. In a direct counter to Kilgore, Lee Drutman, a senior scholar at the New America Foundation, argued in a November 11th essay in Foreign Policy that the Democrats need to give up on appeals to working-class whites. The headline of his article reads, "The GOP has become the party of populism. Now the Democrats have to build a new party of multicultural cosmopolitanism." Drutman argues that, if Democrats define themselves as the party that is opposed to Republicans, as they must, they will soon find themselves as the party of fiscal responsibility, as opposed to the Republicans, who will again run huge deficits, as the party of international responsibility, as opposed to the more isolationist and nationalist Republicans, and as the party of global business, as opposed to the protectionist Republicans. They will continue to be the party of environmentalism. The stakes of this will get even greater soon, and the party of diversity and tolerance. At the policy level, there are substantial objections to the full-scale emergence of a Democratic Party along these lines. It would mean that neither party would represent the economic interests of the bottom half of the income distribution, regardless of race or ethnicity, on crucial issues of tax and spending policies. There is, however, growing evidence that the wheels of electoral politics have made the developments Drutman describes increasingly likely. A comparison of 2004 exit polls and 2016 exit polls reveals the changing relevance of income to voting. In 2004, those with incomes under $30,000 voted Democratic by 20 points. In 2016, these voters voted Democratic by 12 points, a 40% decline. At the upper end, voters with household incomes from $100,000 to $200,000 voted Republican in 2004 by 15 points. In 2016, they voted Republican by 1 point. Voters making more than $200,000 in 2004 voted Republican by 28 points. In 2016, they also voted Republican by 1 point. As Drutman points out, with a President Trump, there is now a change agent to accelerate these forces. In another post-election analysis published on November 15th, Teixeira argues that the conservative victory on Election Day will prove short-lived. In the end, the race will be won by change, as it always is. By 2032, Teixeira writes, "We are far more likely to view the 2016 election as the last stand of America's white working class, dreaming of a past that no longer exists." Maybe. In 2002, Teixeira and John Judas published the classic book The Emerging Democratic Majority, only to see the re-election of George W. Bush 2 years later and the election of Donald Trump 14 years later. Judas, whose most recent book is The Populist Explosion, is less confident than Teixeira. He argues that in this year's election, either John Kasich or Marco Rubio could have beaten Clinton, but the coalition would have looked different, adding in an email, "What I would say, if someone put a gun to my head, is that there is still a stalemate between the two parties in spite of Trump's and the Republicans' success. Trump could fail, the Dems could come back, and then the GOP or Trump could thread the needle and win 2 terms. Not clear what will happen. But politically, leave aside the Census Bureau, the Dems are in disarray." White tribalism or ethnocentrism, whatever you want to call it, is undeniably a powerful force. But so are the identities, loyalties, and resentments of those who have their own competing racial and ethnic commitments. The American experiment, which gives all these interests participatory roles in a dynamic democracy, has long been under strain. Over the next 4 years, it will now be openly tested. The outcome may well be wrenching. 2. The Great Trump Reshuffle. A general election that pits Hillary Clinton against Donald Trump will produce a decisively more affluent and better educated Democratic presidential electorate, and a decidedly less affluent and less educated Republican one than in any previous election going back as far as 1976. It is no secret that Trump is the driving force behind this year's reconfigured coalition on the right. He has successfully appealed to middle and lower-income white voters, motivated by opposition to liberalized attitudes and social norms on matters of race, immigration, and women's rights. Public Opinion Strategies, a Republican polling firm, analyzed a survey conducted in April by NBC and The Wall Street Journal. Respondents were asked to choose between Clinton and Trump, and the results demonstrate that there will be substantial shifts in the income and education levels of Democratic and Republican voters, at least as far as this presidential election is concerned. One of the largest shifts is among college-educated voters, who are expected to defect from the Republican Party by the millions if Trump is the nominee. In 2012, President Barack Obama lost college-educated voters by 4 points. This year, according to Public Opinion Strategies analysis, Clinton will win them by 29 points. In addition, the NBC WSJ poll reveals that Clinton should make substantial gains among voters from households earning in excess of $100,000. While Obama lost these affluent voters in 2012 by 10 points, the NBC WSJ survey shows Clinton carrying them by 12 points. There are two groups among whom Trump will gain and Clinton will lose: voters making less than $30,000, and voters with only high school degrees. Both less affluent groups are expected to increase their level of support for the Republican nominee over their 2012 margins by 13 and by 17 points, respectively. For the Democratic presidential coalition in 2016, the net effect of this shift will be to further reverse the working class tilt of the party, which has been trending upscale since 1992. The Republican coalition of 2016, in fact, will look increasingly like the Democratic Party of the 1930s. A Trump versus Clinton contest will deepen the partisan divisions that have set those who support the social and cultural revolutions of the past 5 decades on race, immigration, women's rights, gender equality, and gay rights, as well as the broader right to sexual privacy, against those who remain in opposition. First, let's take race. Michael Tesler, a political scientist at the University of California, Irvine, examined answers to racial resentment questions in a presidential election panel survey conducted by the Rand Corporation in December and January to see how the responses correlated with presidential voting intentions. The racial resentment scale is based on favorable or unfavorable responses to survey prompts like these: Irish, Italian, Jewish, and many other minorities overcame prejudice and worked their way up. Blacks should do the same without any special favors. Generations of slavery and discrimination have created conditions that make it difficult for blacks to work their way out of the lower class. Over the past few years, blacks have gotten less than they deserve. And it's really a matter of some people not trying hard enough. If blacks would only try harder, they could be just as well off as whites. In addition, the Rand survey sought to measure ethnocentrism by asking respondents to rank their own racial and ethnic group on a 7-point scale for lazy or hardworking, intelligent or unintelligent, and trustworthy or untrustworthy. The respondents were then asked to rate other groups by the same measures. Those ranking their own race or ethnic group higher than others ranked high on ethnocentrism. Tesler's findings are illustrated in Figure 2.1. There was a dose effect. The higher you scored on racial resentment, the more likely you were to support Trump. The more you resented immigrants or professed your white ethnocentrism, the likelier you were to plan to vote for Trump. On March 3rd, Tesler and John Sides, a political scientist at George Washington University, published an article in the Washington Post, "How Political Science Helps Explain the Rise of Trump, the Role of White Identity and Grievances." Using data collected by the American National Election Studies, Tesler and Sides ranked white respondents by their level of white racial identity, determined by asking white respondents questions like, how important is being white to your identity? How important is it that whites work together to change laws that are unfair to whites? And how likely is it that many whites are unable to find a job because employers are hiring minorities instead? Trump's level of support in the survey rose in direct proportion to respondents' level of agreement with each of these statements. Trump has also recruited strong support from those who have not come to terms with the women's rights, reproductive rights, and gay rights movements. Ron Lestag and Lisa Niedert of the University of Michigan's Population Studies Center have done pioneering work that sheds more light on Trump's success so far. They have ranked all 3,140 counties in the United States by their level of entry into what researchers call the Second Demographic Transition, SDT. The Second Demographic Transition, a concise overview of its development by Lestag, summarizes this concept. The SDT starts in the 1960s with a series of multifaceted revolutions. First, there was the contraceptive revolution, with the introduction of hormonal contraception and far more efficient IUDs. Second, there was the sexual revolution, with declining ages at first sexual intercourse. And third, there was the gender revolution, questioning the sole breadwinner household model and the gendered division of labor that accompanied it. These revolutions have reordered much of society. Lestag continues, these three revolutions fit within the framework of an overall rejection of authority, the assertion of individual freedom of choice, autonomy, and an overhaul of the normative structure. The overall outcome of these shifts with respect to fertility was the postponement of childbearing. Mean ages at first parenthood rise again. Opportunities for childbearing are lost due to higher divorce rates. The share of childless, ever-partnered women increases, and higher parity births, four or more, become rare. Table 2.1, which can be found in the print and ebook versions of this book, summarizes the key cultural and social transformations put into effect by this demographic transition. Measured by these criteria, the top-ranked counties were cosmopolitan centers with a larger percentage of affluent, highly educated residents: New York City, the District of Columbia, Pitkin County, Colorado, where Aspen is, San Francisco, and Marin County, California. The counties at the bottom tended to be small, white, rural, poor, and less educated, and they were located in the South and the Mountain West. Millard County, Utah, population 12,662, Loup County, Nebraska, population 576, Perry County, Mississippi, population 12,131, and Roberts County, Texas, population 831. To determine where Trump has been getting his strongest support in terms of the Lestag-Niedert measures, it is useful to study county-level results from the Republican presidential primaries in four states: Ohio, Michigan, Florida, and Tennessee. With rare exceptions, the same pattern emerged in all four states. The lower the SDT ranking, the higher Trump's votes compared with his statewide average. The higher the SDT level, the lower Trump's votes. In many cases, the spread was 10 percentage points or more. Take Manhattan. In these rankings, it is the highest of the 3,140 counties in the United States. Trump won the entire state of New York with 60.4% of the primary vote. In Manhattan, however, Trump lost to John Kasich, the more moderate candidate, 41.8% to 45.2%. Or take two Virginia counties, Arlington and Alexandria, which rank high on the SDT list at 7th and 8th. Trump carried all of Virginia with about 35% of the vote. Marco Rubio came in second with about 32%. But in Alexandria and Arlington, Trump won only 18.8% and 16.8%, respectively. Compare that with two Texas counties, Tyler and San Augustine, which rank near the bottom in the SDT ratings. Trump lost Texas to his former opponent, Ted Cruz, 43.8% to 26.7%. In San Augustine, Trump outperformed his statewide results, winning 39.6% of the county's votes, a 12.9% improvement. In Tyler, Trump received 35.9%, 9.2 points better than his statewide average. Similarly, in Ohio, Trump exceeded his statewide average in 15 out of 18 counties ranked near the bottom on the Lestag-Needert scale, while falling well below his statewide percentage in four metropolitan counties, Franklin, Delaware, Cuyahoga, and Hamilton, near the top of the rankings. The nomination of Trump will sharpen and deepen the Republican Party's core problems. Trump gains the party ground among declining segments of the population, less well-educated, less well-off whites, and loses ground with the growing constituencies, single women, well-educated men and women, minorities, the affluent, and professionals. This is especially true in the case of Trump's dependence on support from communities at the bottom of the Lestag-Needert SDT scale. Not only are more and more Americans adopting the practices and values described by Lestag and Needert, self-expressiveness, gender equality, cohabitation, same-sex couples, postponed marriage and childbearing, but so too is much of the developed world. This transition has effectively become the norm in much of Europe, and as Lestag points out, it is gaining ground in regions as diverse as East Asia and Latin America. In this country, the transition has led to partisan schism. For decades now, the Republican Party has been conducting a racial and cultural counter-revolution. It proved a successful strategy from 1966 to 1992. Since then, as the percentage of Americans on the liberal side of the culture wars has grown steadily, the counter-revolutionary approach has become more and more divisive. In this respect, Trump is not, as many charge, violating core Republican tenets. Instead, he represents the culmination of the rearguard action that has characterized the party for decades. There is a chance that Trump will bring new blood into a revitalized Republican coalition. It is also possible that he will accelerate the Republican Party's downward spiral into irrelevance. 3. Why Trump now? The economic forces driving this year's nomination contests have been at work for decades. Why did the dam break now? The share of the gross national product going to labor, as opposed to capital, fell from 68.8% in 1970 to 60.7% by 2013, according to Lucas Karabarbounis, an economics professor at the University of Chicago's Booth School of Business. Even more devastating, the number of manufacturing jobs dropped by 36% from 19.3 million in 1979 to 12.3 million in 2015, while the population increased by 43% from 225 million to 321 million. The post-war boom, when measured by the purchasing power of the average paycheck, continued into the early 1970s and then abruptly stopped. In other words, the economic basis for voter anger has been building over 40 years. Starting in 2000, two related developments added to worsening conditions for the middle and working classes. First, that year marked the end of net upward mobility. Before 2000, the size of both the lower and middle classes had shrunk, while the percentage of households with inflation-adjusted incomes of $100,000 or more grew. Americans were moving up the ladder. After 2000, the middle class continued to shrink, but so did the percentage of households making $100,000 or more. The only group to grow larger after 2000 was households with incomes of $35,000 or less. Americans were moving down the ladder. This downward shift can be seen in Figure 3.2. The second adverse trend is that trade with China, which shot up after China's entry into the World Trade Organization in December 2001, imposed far larger costs on American workers than most economists anticipated, according to recent studies. And the costs of trade with China have fallen most harshly on workers on the lower rungs of the income ladder. In their January 2016 paper, The China Shock, David Autor, David Dorn, and Gordon Hansen, economists at MIT, the University of Zurich, and the University of California, San Diego, respectively, found that if one had to project the impact of China's momentous economic reform for the U.S. labor market, with nothing to go on other than a standard undergraduate economics textbook, one would predict large movements of workers between U.S. tradable industries, say from apparel and furniture to pharmaceuticals and jet aircraft, limited reallocation of jobs from tradables to non-tradables, and no net impacts on U.S. aggregate employment. The reality of adjustment to the China shock has been far different. Employment has certainly fallen in U.S. industries most exposed to import competition, but so too has overall employment in local labor markets in which these industries were concentrated. Offsetting employment gains either in export-oriented tradables or in non-tradables have, for the most part, failed to materialize. High-wage workers find it relatively easy to adjust and do not experience an earnings loss, argued Autor and his colleagues. Low-wage workers, in contrast, suffer large differential earnings loss as they obtain lower earnings per year, both while working at the initial firm and after relocating to new employers. This is why Donald Trump's charge that China has gotten the better of the United States has gained traction. When I asked Hansen what factors provoked the populist insurgencies in both parties in this particular election cycle, he emailed back, "The recipe for populism seems pretty clear. Take a surge in manufacturing imports from China and continued automation in the U.S. workplace, and add a tepid macroeconomy. The result is a combustible stew sure to sour the stomach of party leaders nationwide." The stew, to continue Hansen's metaphor, began to boil over with the cataclysmic financial collapse in September 2008, which many people, left and right, felt was caused by reckless financial engineering on Wall Street. The collapse and the destruction it left in its wake were, without question, the most important economic and political events in recent years. It was the financial crisis, what it revealed about government-Wall Street links, and the fumbling of the response to it, that put the nail in the coffin of trust in government, Darren Acemoglu, an economist at MIT, wrote in reply to my questions. Once trust in government was destroyed, those that had not benefited from the previous boom years became particularly easy pickings for populist rhetoric. On October 3, 2008, Congress enacted and President George W. Bush signed the Troubled Asset Relief Program. TARP funds bailed out major investment banks and were also used, as the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis put it, to make loans and direct equity investments to select auto industry participants, backstop credit markets, provide a lifeline to the American International Group, AIG, and provide ongoing support for government housing initiatives. But in addition, TARP insulated the very institutions and executives that caused the collapse and the disastrous recession that followed. I don't think you can overestimate or overemphasize the impact of the bailout, Norm Ornstein, a scholar at the American Enterprise Institute, a center-right Washington think tank, told me in an email. The widespread sense that all the elites in Washington and New York conspired to bail out the miscreants who caused the disaster and then gave them bonuses, while the rest of us lost our houses or saw their value, the biggest and often only asset of Americans, plummet, lost our jobs or saw them frozen and stagnant, and then saw gaping inequality grow even more, is just palpable. On January 10, 2010, the Supreme Court granted those in upper income brackets additional privileges in its Citizens United decision, buttressed by subsequent lower court rulings, that allowed wealthy individuals, corporations, and unions to make unlimited political contributions. by opening the door to the creation of super PACs, political action committees, and giving Wall Street and other major financial sectors new ways to buy political outcomes, the courts gave the impression, to say the least, that they favored establishment interests over those of the less well-off. A Bloomberg poll last September found that 78% of voters would like to see Citizens United overturned, and this view held across a range of partisan loyalties, Republicans at 80%, Democrats at 83%, and Independents at 71%. In March 2010, 2 months after Citizens United was decided, President Barack Obama signed the Affordable Care Act, aka Obamacare, a program many in the white middle and working classes perceived as reducing their own medical care in order to provide health coverage to the disproportionately minority poor. By the midterm elections of 2010, voter dissatisfaction among whites found expression in the Tea Party movement, which produced the sweeping defeat of Democrats in competitive congressional districts, as well as of moderate and center-right Republicans in primary contests. Voter anger was directed at two targets, the undeserving rich and the undeserving poor. The 2010 election pattern was repeated in the 2014 midterms. To many of those who cast their ballots in anger in 2010 and 2014, however, it appeared that their votes had not changed anything. Obamacare stayed in place, and Wall Street and corporate America grew richer, while the average worker was stuck going nowhere. Already disillusioned with the Democratic Party, these white voters became convinced that the mainstream of the Republican Party had failed them, not only on economic issues, but on cultural matters as well. A September 2015 Ipsos survey asked voters if they agreed or disagreed with the statement, "More and more, I don't identify with what America has become." Of surveyed Republicans, 72% concurred, compared with 58% of independents and 45% of Democrats. Two-thirds of Republicans, 62%, agreed with the statement, "These days I feel like a stranger in my own country," compared with 53% of independents and 37% of Democrats. Here is one place where Trump's scathing dismissal of political correctness found fertile ground. Jared Bernstein, a senior fellow at the Center for Budget and Policy Priorities, described in blunt terms the consequences of disillusionment with old guard Republicans. The intersection of inequality driven by real wage, income stagnation, and the fact that the folks perceived to have blown the damn economy up not only recovered first, but got government assistance in the form of bailouts to do so. If you're in the anxious middle, and that doesn't deeply piss you off, you're an unusually forgiving person. In these circumstances, Bernstein wrote, the logic supporting the traditional Republican Party fell apart. The core theme of Republican establishment lore has been to demonize not unregulated finance or trade or inequality, but the other. For example, the immigrant or minority taking your job or claiming unneeded government support. And yet, none of their trickle-down, deregulatory agenda helped ameliorate the problem at all. So they lost control. Just as animosity to Republican power brokers in Washington intensified, the Republican Party began to splinter. I asked Nathan Persily, a Stanford law professor, are party establishments now fictions, no longer able to exercise control? Persily responded, this election has demonstrated that there is no Republican Party organization per se. The Republican Party exists as an array of allied groups, incumbent office holders, media organizations, and funding vehicles, for example, super PACs, 501c4s, and the like. When people ask why the establishment or the party has not done anything to stop Trump, it is not exactly clear who they mean. On Super Tuesday, Trump won a majority of the dozen states that were up for grabs. He collected far more delegates than Ted Cruz or Marco Rubio. The tragedy of the 2016 campaign is that Trump has mobilized a constituency with legitimate grievances on a fool's errand. If he is shoved out of the field somehow, his supporters will remain bitter and enraged, convinced that a self-serving and malign elite defeated their leader. If he prevails, a constituency that could force politicians to confront the problems of the working and middle class will waste its energies on a candidate incompetent to improve the lives of the credulous men and women lining up to support him. 4. How the Other Fifth Lives. For years now, people have been talking about the insulated world of the top 1% of Americans. But the top 20% of the income distribution is also steadily separating itself, by geography and by education, as well as by income. This self-segregation of a privileged fifth of the population is changing the American social order and the American political system, creating a self-perpetuating class at the top, which is ever more difficult to break into. Figure 4.1, taken from The Continuing Increase in Income Segregation, a March 2016 paper by Sean F. Reardon, a professor of education at Stanford, and Kendra Bischoff, a professor of sociology at Cornell, demonstrates the accelerating geographic isolation of the well-to-do, the upper middle and upper classes, a pattern of isolation that also applies to the poor with devastating effect. In hard numbers, the percentage of families with children living in very affluent neighborhoods more than doubled between 1970 and 2012, from 6.6% to 15.7%. At the same time, the percentage of families with children living in traditional middle-class neighborhoods with median incomes between 80 and 125% of the surrounding metropolitan area fell from 64.7% in 1970 to 40.5%. Reardon and Bischoff write, "Segregation of affluence not only concentrates income and wealth in a small number of communities, but also concentrates social capital and political power. As a result, any self-interested investment the rich make in their own communities has little chance of spilling over to benefit middle and low-income families. In addition, it is increasingly unlikely that high-income families interact with middle and low-income families, eroding some of the social empathy."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.